morning. It's Pastor Steve, and you're with Grove Church, our online service. We're actually meeting right now in person and online at 10:45. If you want to join us in person, just call the church office. Don't text. Call or email us, and we'd love to worship God with you in person. But right now, we're just so pleased that you have taken the space to carve out to spend with God and with us. So thank you for coming. We're so glad that you're here with us. One thing, maybe there's someone on your timeline that might benefit from this message. So feel free to share, to like or comment. That way we can impact others with the good news that God is doing here with us. So if you're new with us, this is what we normally do. We have a call to worship, which is scriptures that remind us that we should carve this time out to worship God. Then we have a prayer of confession, realizing that sometimes that is not only things outside the world that's messed up. Sometimes we are either damaged by it or we're contributing it to it in some way. So we need God to mend us and to fix us, to heal us and heal our world. So we have a prayer of confession and the words of assurance, which is scriptures that God once again tells us that he is going to come and fix our lives. He is going to come and fix our world. After that, we have a message for the kids. So if you have little ones, make sure they're come up to the screen at that point. And then we worship God in song, and there's a familiar hymn. But if it's not familiar to you, don't worry. We have the lyrics right there on the screen with you. And you'll hear the scripture being read, and I'll preach a sermon of maybe God wants to speak to you this morning through his word. And then we close our time, and there's a song of worship to lead you, to transition you to back to the things that are in your plate and in your home. So thanks again for coming, and our call to worship this morning is from Psalm 89. The scripture says, I will sing of your steadfast love, O Lord, forever. With my mouth I will proclaim your faithfulness to all generations. I declare that your steadfast love is established forever, your faithfulness as firm as the heavens. You said, I've made a covenant with my chosen when I've sworn to my servant David. I will establish your descendants forever and build your throne for all generations. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. As we realize that God has promised and kept his promise to us, we have fallen short of our promise. So I'm going to pray a prayer of confession. And if it resonates with you, just meditate on these words. Just talk to God. Or just reflect. Let us pray. Father, you tell us in your word that everything that does not come from faith is a sin. We confess that we have frequently relaxed our faith. We have allowed ourselves to become cynical, and our cynicism has boiled over with slander, criticism, prayerlessness, and pessimism. How easily we've allowed ourselves to crumple under the stresses of our lives. Forgive us for our smallness of faith. In your mercy, hear us. For Jesus' sake, amen. Amen. And hear the promise of God's forgiveness from Colossians chapter 2. You were dead because you were sinful and were not God's people. But God let Christ make you alive when he forgave all our sins. God wiped out the charges that were against us for disobeying the law of Moses. He took them away and nailed them to the cross. Thanks be to God. Actually, those are some of my favorite words in scripture. Not the whole verse, but the but God, right? We were dead in our sins, but God. Something is happening in your life, but God can change it, right? We were hopeless, but God brought hope. We were going astray. We were discouraged, but God. As we celebrate that God's interruption of goodness in our lives, that God has given us peace through Christ, so let us pass the peace of Christ to each other. The peace of Christ be with you at home and also with you. So online in the comments, let us participate and share the good news of Christ's peace. Peace be with you. Welcome. Good morning. I'm so glad you're participating with us. The peace of Christ be with you as well.
Will the children gather around as we go downstairs to the kidmin room and have a message for them?
Hey kids, it's Pastor Steve, and I'm in our kid ministry room, and I'm so glad to spend this time with you online learning about God's Word. So before we jump into God's Word, I have a question for you. Who lives in your house? Yeah, like who's right next to you right now? Who sleeps there? I'm listening. Okay. Very interesting. Well, today I want to talk about a king, King David, who wanted to build a house. He had a big house himself, a palace actually, because he was a king. And he said, hey, I should build a big house for God. Because you see, they were worshiping God in a tent called a tabernacle. And he said, let me build a big house for God. And God said, no, I don't need a big house. So I'm wondering, where is God's house? So right now, you're at your house. Right now, I'm at the Grove Church building, right? I'm in the kid ministry room. If you remember, upstairs is the sanctuary where I just was. And that is, sometimes we think of that as God's house. But how big is God? Is he as big as this building? Is he as big as the world? Is he bigger than the world? So then how is this Grove Church building his house? You see, the church building helps us to worship God. It's a place where we could focus on God, we could not be distracted, and hopefully soon we'll be there again and that way. Because sometimes at home, right, it's hard, it's distracted, there's things that are happening, you're eating snacks, or you're coloring, or, you know, you're still in your pajamas, and you know, all this stuff, right? Sometimes it's distracting. Maybe even on the phone or the TV you're watching, there's little things popping up sometimes. So the church building is for us. It helps us to focus on God. Sometimes we call it God's house, but it's really our place to remember to focus on God without distractions. God doesn't need a house. He doesn't need a house because he's not just here in this building, right? Because he's in your house. Did you mention God when you said who lives in your house? Because God's there too. God's in your heart, right? When we're forever friends with Jesus, God's in our heart. Be God in our heart, in our houses, in church buildings, outside at the park. God is there. He made our world and heaven. God is there. God's at home everywhere. He doesn't need a building to fit in because he's too big for that. But God wants to live with us. He wants to spend time in our lives, in our hearts, we say. So God doesn't need a house. He doesn't need a building to stay in because he's bigger than a building. But he wants to be our friend forever. And he lives with us in the hearts of all his friends. Let us pray. God, we thank you, Lord, that a big God like you wants to be with little people too. We thank you, God, that you're not in a faraway building, but wherever people are watching this, Lord, that you are there. You are there on the couch. You are there in the kitchen. Lord, you're there in our bedrooms. Thank you, God, for making yourself at home in our lives. That buildings are great and beautiful, but you are bigger than that. And you could reach us and see us and be with us and hear our prayers wherever we are. In your name we pray, amen. Amen, guys. It's so good to pray with you, even though we're far. God connects us, right? God keeps us close together. We're gonna worship God together, because guess what? God could hear you at your house. God could hear me here near the Grove Church building. And we're gonna worship God. And I hope to hear you sing and worship God together.
Lord, give us a vision of what you desire of us. Be our vision today. Be thou a vision, O Lord of my heart. Not be all else to me, save that thou art. Thou my best Lord, by day or night.
Hear now God's word. After the king was settled in his palace, and the Lord had given him rest from all his enemies around him, he said to Nathan, the prophet, "Here I am, living in a house of cedar, while the ark of God remains in a tent." Nathan replied to the king, "Whatever you have in mind, go ahead and do it, for the Lord is with you." But that night, the word of the Lord came to Nathan, saying,
"Go and tell my servant David, this is what the Lord says. Are you the one to build me a house to dwell in? I have not dwelt in a house from the day I brought the Israelites up out of Egypt to this day. I have been moving from place to place with a tent as my dwelling. Wherever I have moved with all the Israelites, did I ever say to any of their rulers whom I commanded to shepherd my people Israel, 'Why have you not built me a house of cedar?' Now then, tell my servant David, this is what the Lord Almighty says. I took you from the pasture, from tending the flock, and appointed you ruler over my people Israel. I have been with you wherever you have gone, and I have cut off all your enemies from before you. Now I will make your name great, like the names of the greatest men on earth, and I will provide a place for my people Israel, and will plant them so that they can have a home of their own and no longer be disturbed. Wicked people will not oppress them anymore, as they did at the beginning and have done ever since the time I appointed leaders over my people Israel. I will also give you rest from all your enemies. The Lord declares to you that the Lord himself will establish a house for you. When your days are over and you rest with your ancestors, I will raise up your offspring to succeed you, your own flesh and blood, and I will establish his kingdom. He is the one who will build a house for my name, and I will establish the throne of his kingdom forever. I will be his father, and he will be my son. When he does wrong, I will punish him with a rod wielded by men, with floggings inflicted by human hands. But my love will never be taken away from him, as I took it away from Saul, whom I removed from before you. Your house and your kingdom will endure forever before me. Your throne will be established forever."
Nathan reported to David all the words of this entire revelation. Praise be to God. Let us pray. God, we thank you for the gift of your word. We thank you that you still speak to us, your people. Lord, help us to receive what you have prepared for us. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. If you were asked in 2015, what would you be doing in 5 years from now? How many of you would have been accurate in your guess? I know I was way off. Right? Who would envision the current realities of 2020? Church online or outdoors? Toilet paper shortages? Closed doors of schools and businesses? How many of you had to go back to your car at your house because you forgot your mask? Who would have thunk it? 8 years ago, I moved into North Bergen as a new pastor from warm Florida. And of course, what happens is when new pastors, you have a little bit of a dream, a little bit of a passion, wondering what God is going to do. I had hopes of what God was starting and what the community would be. I had some idea of some of the challenges I might face in that role. But I realized that I did not have a clue of what was to come. To be honest with you, I didn't have a clue of what my household would even look like 8 years ago, much less what Grove Church and our community would be going through or looking through. If you asked me what we would be doing in autumn of 2020, even a year ago, my answers would have been different. I would think that we were participating in our biggest trunk or treat ever, since it seemed to be growing and building up momentum. I would say that our summer kids club that we had reached and had new members of the community. I would never have guessed that we have, our congregation, some of them joining us from online home and some of us joining here in person. I didn't see this coming. You see, our imagination and our projection of what could happen only goes so far. And we've had some conversations. I mean, the consistory, we've talked about having Zoom meetings a couple years ago, and we talked about exploring digital giving a couple years ago. But we didn't know that that would be the mainstay and the norm of culture, right? We're living in a year when weddings that have been planned for years, have been canceled. We are living in a time where steady jobs have disappeared. We live in a time we're still trying to figure out how do we celebrate good things like anniversaries and birthdays and how many people you should gather around your Thanksgiving table if you're going to have Thanksgiving with the people that you always have Thanksgiving with. We're at a time where we're having trouble figuring out how do we grieve? How do we grieve the loss of jobs and the loss of life? How we grieve the things that have come to a close? Probably one of the most useless things of 2020 has been my planner, because I did not see this coming. Hopefully it gets recycled into something helpful, maybe toilet paper, so the shortage would be less impacted. And our scripture this morning, King David has some thoughts on what would be helpful in the future. He was the king of Israel, and he had a beautiful new palace. And he was thinking about how the Ark of the Covenant, the kind of symbol, the physical presence of God was being carried around in a tent, in the tabernacle. So King David is seeing his new luxuries and telling the prophet Nathan that he thinks that God would be good in a palace, something like his, right? It seems like a good idea. I have a palace. Shouldn't God's presence have something nice and fancy to dwell in? And Nathan the prophet kind of hears and says, hey, yeah, God, that's a good idea. That makes sense. King David has a nice house. Let's make a nice house for God. Right? So you have these two men of faith, and you're saying, let's do this. God needs a house. God deserves a house. It reminds me a little bit when a guy asks another guy for advice on what to get their girlfriend or their wife, right? You have your guy friend, so you ask the guy, like, is this, would this be a good gift? Is this a good idea? And the guy's like, yeah, that's a great idea. She would love it. And then you give the gift to your significant other, and she's not as thrilled as your guy friend is. Right? What could go wrong? How could she not need that vacuum? That's the top of line. You know how much money those vacuums cost? You can pick up a bowling ball. Right? But it doesn't, we don't surprise that your guy friend and you have a, don't can give a gift or have in mind what she needs. I'd be curious, and now we're going to do this now, but what would be the worst gift that your significant other ever got you thinking it was a good idea? And if our friends and family, if our loved ones can't figure out what a good gift for us is, maybe King David and the prophet Nathan, maybe they were a little off on what God really wanted or needed at that moment. Maybe that shouldn't surprise us that these
men of God missed the mark on the house of God idea. It makes me wonder, is this what God wanted? Or is this what King David wanted? Some commentators believe that David building a temple would be an item of his legacy, would be kind of a showcase. So him building God a house was for God, but it was also for him. It was also a way to kind of anchor God to a certain spot. You know, if God's presence were in this physical building, then God is here right next to me. So his plans, his thinking of what God was part of building his own legacy and building his own security. But God didn't want the building. God actually said that he's gonna, you know, that David's gonna have a son, and his son, Solomon, will build that. And actually, like, God is not that focused on the building, but he's gonna build a household, a dynasty for David. God was more concerned with what he's gonna do with the people of God than a temple with cedar walls. Here we are today on a cool autumn day. And those here in person, I'm sure you thought about some of the advantages of worshiping inside. Maybe, you know, maybe it would be a little bit nicer than inside or in a tent. But that doesn't seem to be God's greatest concern in our scripture. Whether we're worshiping him online or in a building or outdoors, God wants to work through his people. God wants to work through you and I. And I know I've had some concerns, some people very concerned and passionate about how worship has to happen in that building. There's some folks that have a lot of energy towards that. But I don't think that in 2 Samuel or right now that is God's first priority. I love the wooden cedar walls. I don't know what our walls are made of, but the beautiful wooden walls. But I don't think that is the first priority of God. God wants to work through his people. God wants to reign in our lives. He wants to proclaim the gospel to our neighborhoods. He wants to be exalted in all we do. And I don't think he's as concerned as we are about worshiping among beautiful wooden walls. At least that's what our scripture this morning would lead us to believe. It's important, but I don't think it's on the top three priority of God's checklist for us. You see, our human nature is to act like our priorities and God's priorities are the same. But most likely they're not. These are the wrong types of leaps that we make. The wrong type of leaps that King David and Nathan made. You know, it's not a biblical leap of faith is when Jesus tells people to come walk on the water and then take that step. A biblical leap of faith is when Jesus just gives us, you know, a dozen loaves of bread and says, feed those people. And we do it in faith. A biblical leap of faith is when Jesus says, turn away from security on your own and turn away from running life on your own terms and trust me as Lord and Savior. And we come to faith. And we live that faith decision by decision. And as we trust in the ways of the Lord. Those are the leaps of faith that the scripture leads us to. When we trust God and take him at his word and know that he will keep his promise to us. But there's these other leaps that we often take. When we think that our agenda is God's agenda, that we fill in the blanks and assume that God's plan and motives are the same as our own. We assume that God wants us to build him a temple because why wouldn't he? We assume that God wants us inside our building because why wouldn't he? We assume that God wants us to vote for this political party because we've always voted that way. We assume that God wants me to do X, Y, Z because God wants me to be happy. Of course he'd want me to do that. We take leaps of liberties by putting our imperfect and short-sighted agenda by saying they must be God's. It just makes sense. It's dangerous to just assume what God wants. It's dangerous to assume that God always wants what we want and that God's priorities are always our priorities. When we put words in God's mouth, we miss what God is doing. We miss what God wants to do. We focus more on what we want done. Imagine if God just went along with David's plan. If God was like, oh, yeah, sure, build, yeah, cedar wood? Sounds cozy. Yeah, build that. I was thinking about building a legacy of a Davidic line, maybe putting Jesus at the somewhere in part of that to be King of Kings and Lord of Lords forever, but cedar is nice. Right? Imagine if that was God's like, oh, you know, we'll just go with what he said. Sounds like a good idea. Why not? Right? Promising Jesus was a better plan than building of any temples. God's ways are better than our ways. When God said no to the temple that David wanted, he knew that the Davidic line would bear much more fruit for all of humanity. I'm so glad that God said no to David. But it's hard to celebrate when God says no to us. Like David, we cannot see the fruit of God's yeses, right? There's no way David and Nathan could comprehend what God was doing. It's hard when God says no to something that seems like a no-brainer. Of course God should be doing that. Of course God will be pleased with that. Because we cannot see the fruit of God's no's and his yeses. So let's not assume that our plans, that our perspective, that our priorities are lined up with God's. God's ways are higher than our ways. So even kings and prophets can get it wrong. So while we can't trust our perception, we can trust God, that God has it right. That God's ways are better than our ways, that his no's might be a yes to something we don't even know he's doing. That we can rejoice when doors are closed. That we can take some time before jumping and leaping to our own liberties and assumptions. We can come to God and say, as we do in the Lord's Prayer, that his will be done on earth as it is in heaven. God's ways are not our ways. And that's something to thank God about. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Maybe Dorothy Willis is going to lead us in our prayers for special needs.
O God, our Father, whose will for us and for all your people is health and salvation, we seek your mercy. O God, the Son who came that we might have life and have it in abundance, have mercy on us. O God, Holy Spirit, whose indwelling makes our bodies the temples of your presence, pour down your mercy upon us. You join me in prayer. O Triune God, we pray that you would hear us and that you will grant your grace to all who stand in need of healing, both of body and spirit, and look with and lead them to look with confidence to you. We think of those, O Lord, who are dealing with a diagnosis of cancer, who are struggling with the return of a previous diagnosis of cancer. And we think of the loving families who share concern for their well-being. Lord, we think of those who are awaiting medical tests or awaiting results. And we think of those who have ongoing medical needs and concerns and the difficulty and the stress they may be facing in seeking care in these difficult times. We think of all of those who are suffering from this virus, or who are suffering with lingering after effects. And we lift these people up to you, O Lord. O Sovereign God, we pray that you will grant patience and perseverance to all who are troubled in heart or mind and seek your guidance. Set their minds at rest. We especially think of those who have lost jobs in this difficult time and are seeking employment in very difficult circumstances. We think of those who have continued on jobs but with lesser hours and are facing financial difficulties because of that. We think, O Lord, of all those in the western part of our country who are in danger in the path of wildfires that just don't seem to come under control. We pray for those in our own family who have been traveling, and we pray that for their safe return to our gathering and that they may return soon in health. Oh, compassionate God, we pray that you hear the names of those who your Spirit has laid upon our hearts and meet their varied needs as we recall their names before you now in a moment of silence. Loving God, we lift up our hearts to you in a time of thanksgiving that you are ever present in our midst, be it in our gatherings here or in our gatherings at a distance because of the circumstances which separate us. We know that in difficult times we can remember, along with the psalmist, you are our light and our salvation. You are the strength of our lives. Of whom shall we be afraid? In the time of trouble, you hide us and you set us high upon a rock. And as we wait on you, we can be of good courage, for you will strengthen our hearts. O God, who in Jesus Christ called us out of the darkness and into your marvelous light, enable us always to declare your wonderful deeds, to thank you for your steadfast love, and praise you with heart, soul, mind, and strength, and faithfully pray together as we were instructed by our Lord, boldly saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. And for those of us who are outdoors today, although the sun has gone in, and the chill is in the air, it does not lessen the warmth of these greetings that we now bring, Pastor Steve and Hope. You have made reference this morning to the fact that you've been with us. Actually, November 1st will be the 8th anniversary of your time, and the beginning of your time with us. And we have been and continue to be grateful to God for you, for your family, for all the ways in which you have served us and loved us, and not just us, but our community as well, and for all of the extra effort and time and outpouring that this 2020 season has required and has laid upon you, which you have so graciously embraced and just stepped up and been there for us in person, in prayer, in love. We are grateful and we thank you. And so I'd like to say that this is just a small token of our appreciation and gratitude to you. To Hope, I have to say special words in addition for all that you have been doing for our families and to keep us together, even when we are physically separated, and to keep our young people connected to God. And this could not happen without the support of your family. And so we thank you too for sharing your parents with us for those times when they might be physically at home, but really involved mentally and every other way in working for others. We thank you for sharing that time with us. If not today, by tomorrow, we'll check your inbox, your email, and we hope that there will be a little something there to help you in the effort of food delivery these days, to get that to you a little bit more easily and to deal with that. And so again, we just appreciate you all so much and thank you for all that you do.
Such a pleasure to share God's word with you. Thank you for your recognition of my 8 years of pastoral ministry here, and it's a pleasure to be your pastor even during these challenging times. So thank you for your thoughtfulness there. It's also Reformation Sunday, where we remember our roots as a church and God's work in and through the church. Speaking of that, this is the time in our service where we encourage people to respond in generosity. God has given us so much, and we ask that you give back to God. One of those ways is through the giving of tithes and offerings, and thank you for those who've supported us financially, as we support others too, other ministries financially. This week, I met with our friends from the River Mission in Hackensack. They, throughout the pandemic, they've been having worship services in a Hackensack park, and now they're just starting this Sunday. They're starting to be able to give food away to those who are homeless and on the fringe. They've always had like a supper after their Sunday afternoon services, but this time they're doing takeout bags of sandwiches so their homeless friends and congregants can worship God. So thank you for your supporting us, that we may be one of the contributors to the River Mission. And this evening, why don't you pray for our friends at the River Mission as they strive to serve God in their context. And also, of course, we always welcome not only your prayers for them and for us, but we want to pray for you. So right online, you can pray, give us your prayer request as we lift those up, just like Dorothy did a few moments ago. Receive this blessing as you go to your different places. May God bless you and keep you. May his face shine upon you and be gracious to you, now and always. Amen. Amen.
Stand as you are able. Thank God that he calls us a friend. Thank you. dear friend. Thank you, Lord. You are our Lord and our Savior. But don't ask to be as close as a friend to you. God Almighty. Thank you, Lord.